BBC One's making a splash with Total Wipeout at 5:40 right now on the first Saturday of the new football season. It's the return of Final Score with Gabby Logan.
He was one of the heroes of the afternoon.
Applause from the away supporters. Go!
The latest score is Wimbledon.
Go through to the Premier League.
John Terry's tears, we all remember.
It was a two crucial week.
Manchester United 4, Blackpool 2.
Welcome to Final Score. Where have you been? We've been on the red button since 2:30, enjoying the first afternoon of football this season. And now you're here. Welcome back to the fold. And let me introduce you to Matt Holland and Steve Claridge, who've been enjoying a feast of football. This is what's going on in the Championship so far today. A busy afternoon at the new Amex Stadium, but it's Brighton trailing to Doncaster 1-0. Billy Sharp's goal, meaning that Gus Poyet's debut in the Championship not going very well at the moment. He's also been sent to the stands. Bristol City 0, Ipswich 3. Ipswich cruising at Ashton Gate. Michael Chopra has netted twice for his new team. It's Burnley 0 and Watford 2. Craig Forsyth and Mark Yates have put Watford and Sean Dyche's first game as Hornets boss ahead. At Coventry lost in the lunchtime fixture to Leicester. Sven's big spending Leicester off to a winning start thanks to Lee Peltier, one of his new signings. Derby 2, Birmingham 1. Birmingham trailing at Pride Park, their first game since relegation, of course, from the Premier League. Jason Shackle and Steve Davis have netted for the Rams. It's Middlesbrough 2, Portsmouth 1. Borough leading Pompey thanks to goals from Marvin Emnes and Reece Williams. Nottingham Forest 0, Barnsley 0. Former England boss Steve McLaren's first match as Forest boss. Peterborough 1, Crystal Palace 1. Sean Scannell put Palace in front against newly promoted Posh, but Grant McCann has equalised. Reading 0, Millwall 2. The Lions leading at the Majeski thanks to James Henry and John Marquis. And it's Southampton Leeds is an evening kickoff. OK, let's go first of all to the Amex. It's not going to the script so far, Tony Husband. All the pomp and circumstance and the hype before the match, which was justified. Brighton can't convert it on the pitch at the moment.
No, Gabby, Brighton Hove Albion opening this fantastic £93 million new Amex Stadium. High emotions before the game, perhaps almost a little bit too much hype as we went into the match. In the first half, Gus Poyet sent from the dugout after a clash with an assistant referee. He's watching the match now from just a seat four rows along from me in the press box. Injury hit Doncaster, though, 12 without a win at the end of last season. Many people's favourites for relegation this season, but they grabbed a first-half lead through Billy Sharp. His effort going in off the post. Sharp has since been stretched off, the injury woes continuing for Sean O'Driscoll's men. In the second half, Brighton have pushed hard for an equaliser, none harder than Craig Noon, a substitute who shot wide with the goal at his mercy. 20 minutes to play and Brighton behind on this opening day.
Tony, thank you very much. There's a goal at London Road, so let's go there now. Steve Lee.
Peterborough 2, Palace 1. A good fight back this by Peterborough. They trail to a Sean Scannell goal in the first half. Palace very much the team with the ability in the first half, but in the second half they've fought back. Grant McCann equalised, and now substitute David Ball has headed them into a 2-1 lead from Tomlin's cross. Good game this.
Thanks, Steve. And Derby have done the same thing. Ivan Gaskell at Pride Park fought back from a goal down.
Yes, after a sluggish start and deservedly behind to a Curtis Davis header, Derby dug in and turned things around here. The shackles came off as skipper Jason Shackle levelled. Then they were in front, Derby, just before the break. Jamie Ward might have extended the Derby lead twice after Stephen Davis had rifled them in front for half-time, but he didn't. Now Birmingham mounting a spirited finale here. Burke has just clipped a fine shot against a Derby post. Stephen Carr lashed the rebound into the Birmingham fans. Experience isn't everything. 2-1 here.
Ivan, thank you. Indeed, you're right, because Sean Dyche's first game in charge of Watford is going very well. Indeed, the rookie manager's side 2-0 up at Turf Moor. Damian Johnson.
Yep, two debutants have given Watford the advantage here at Turf Moor. Craig Forsyth's first half header gave them the half-time lead against the run of play, it must be said. A few minutes ago, a defensive mix-up and Mark Yates broke clear to score. Burnley only have themselves to blame. They've created chances, but been wasteful in front of goal. Burnley legend Jimmy McElroy received his MBE on the pitch before kickoff. That's about as good as it's got for the home fans. 2-0 Watford lead.
Damien, thank you very much. Not a good day for the home fans at Ashton Gate. Hamish Marshall.
Yeah, that's because it's Bristol City 0, Ipswich 3. Six debutants and Paul Jewell's side today, and they've gelled from the off, helped along the way with two goals from Michael Chopra. The first lobbing the advancing David James, the second taking advantage of a poor clearance from the former England keeper. In the middle was a perfectly placed 20-yard effort from Lee Martin. City have brought a couple of saves from the new Ipswich keeper, David Stockdale, but there's only one winner here.
Hamish, thank you very much. Let's go back to Turf Moor. A goal. Has it just got better for the home side?
It has. They've pulled one back through Charlie Austin, a second-half substitute. Remember, he was prolific for Swindon a season or two ago. It was a shot from the edge of the block, edge of the box, and Austin just got in the way of it. The ball flew in off, I'm not sure which part of it is anatomy, and into the net past Scott Loach. It's Burnley 1, Watford 2.
Reading had that amazing end to the season. Couldn't quite push it through the playoffs, could they? And everybody expected them to start strongly this time, but it's not going to plan at the Majeski, Mark Bishop.
Bad day at the office for Brian McDermott, definitely, Gabby. Reading 0, Millwall 2. Visitors on course for their first league win over Reading in 7 years. They've stormed out of the blocks after the restart. Former Royal Darius Henderson on his debut for the Lions, heading Millwall into the lead 4 minutes into the second half. Reading shell-shock. They've looked jittery at the back all second half. Millwall then double their lead. 19-year-old striker John Marquis, sporting a vintage Steve McLaren hairstyle. Check it out on Google. Headed in at the far post. Hair raising for Millwall, though, inside 30 seconds. Ford doing well to deny Noel Hunt as he stormed into the penalty area. But it's Millwall in the ascendancy. 0-2.
Thank you very much, Mark. Let's go to the Riverside Stadium. Middlesbrough not just fighting Portsmouth this afternoon, but the weather as well, Steve Sutton.
Yes, Middlesbrough lead by 2-1, Gabby, but a first half of constant heavy rainfall has made one or two areas of the pitch pretty difficult to play. The players kicking up surface water if they run through them. But the story of the goals, Middlesbrough took the lead on 24 minutes. Against a run of play, it has to be said, Marvin Emnes with the finish. But just after the restart of the second half, David Norris had equalised for Portsmouth. But that joy lasted just 7 minutes. Reece Williams with restoring Middlesbrough's lead. And just to emphasise the conditions of the pitch there, Joe Bennett, number 3, has just done a beautiful belly flop dive right through the biggest puddle on the pitch. Middlesbrough 2, Portsmouth 1.
Thank you very much, Steve. Uwe Rosler's Brentford have doubled their lead against Yeovil at Griffin Park. I'm only telling you because the goal scorer is called Logan. And Paolo Di Canio's Swindon are now 3-0 up against Crewe. Aidan Flint with the goal on 77 minutes. But let's go back to the Championship and to the City Ground. Former England boss Steve McLaren has taken charge of Nottingham Forest this summer, but his side just can't break the deadlock today.
No, it's been disappointing for them, Gabby. It's Forest 0, Barnsley 0. Bright sunshine on Trentside, so we've had no signs of an umbrella for Steve McLaren. In fact, he's been throwing his hands around all afternoon. He's looked very frustrated at a very disappointing Forest side. They lost 9 players during the summer. They've brought only 3 in. All 3 of those have been in his midfield today. Andy Reid, George Boateng and Jonathan Greening. But they've struggled against a Barnsley side looking very well organised under Keith Hill. The manager, of course, came to Barnsley from Rochdale last season. Barnsley have been perhaps the better side. Forest struggling in front of 22,000 fans. It's 0-0.
Andrew, thank you very much. Let's go up to the SPL and to Brian McLaughlin at East End Park. There's been a goal since the last time we spoke.
Yeah, terrific game here, Gabby. It's now Dunfermline 2, Cali Thistle 2. Twice Dunfermline have been ahead, and that was almost another third goal for Dunfermline this afternoon. It was the Martin Hardy there with a shot from 18 yards just over the crossbar. In fact, has been tipped over. Dunfermline twice been ahead through Andy Kirk in the half hour, and then 8 minutes into the second half, Greg Tansey pulled one back for Cali Thistle just a minute into the second half, and then Johnny Hayes scored an equaliser for Cali Thistle after the goalkeeper spilled another Tansey shot from 25 yards. It has been end-to-end stuff since then, Gabby. Could be a winner. It won't be Andy Kirk's hat-trick, though, because he's been replaced by Nick Ross, who came close to adding a third goal for Dunfermline as well. It's Dunfermline 2, Cali Thistle 2, 10 minutes left for play.
Brian, thank you very much. Bury have got an equaliser at the Gull Farm. We'll go and find out about that soon. But let's go to Tannadice. Ian Turner is something of a mystic Meg. He promised a goal on the red button and they delivered, Dundee United.
I'll give you the lottery numbers later, Gabby, but yes, as predicted, Dundee United have equalised. Scott Allen's low cross from the left turned home by captain John Daly, and that one, as I said, was definitely on the cards after Nigel Hasselbank was sent off just at the tail end of the first half for apparently elbowing one of the United players as he made his way into the box. A first half in which Stephen Thompson had given Saints an early lead with a close range shot. It's a very, very good game at Tannadice. Dundee United won, St Mirren won, and poised nicely.
Thank you very much. Let's go to the Valley. A good start to the season for Charlton. Robin Bailey's been watching them against Bournemouth.
Yes, it looks very good now because Johnny Jackson has just scored a penalty. Bradley Wright Phillips was taken down in the area, no question. And Jackson just side-footed it home to get them 3-0 up. It's game over now, but Bournemouth did have a couple of chances. You know, they got delayed on the M25 for hours and hours last night. They got into London late. They wanted a late kickoff, apparently. There was no late kickoff. They were totally asleep in the first half. We saw two cracking goals in this game. Dale Stevens, one of 17 new signings, got a goal in the first half, and Scott Wagstaff, a wonderful right-footed volley. Charlton going well, 3-0.
Both your old teams, Charlton and Bournemouth. Good start, obviously, for Charlton today. They obviously are one of the teams in League One that you'd expect to be pushing near the top, and you were saying earlier on it's a much more open league than it was perhaps last season.
I think it's very open. Obviously, last year Brighton ran away with it. This year, I think Huddersfield will start as favourites. Charlton has been a big turnaround in personnel. They brought 8 or 9 new players in, and it might take time. Today, they've got a terrific result today against Bournemouth, one of my old clubs. We got into the playoffs last year, but they've lost a couple of key players, and Anton Robinson went to Huddersfield this week as well. So it's going to be tough for them, I think, this year to emulate what they did last season.
Meanwhile, one of his other old teams, Ipswich, winning 3-0 at Ashton Gate. Yeah. You had them in the top six in your predictions earlier on. Obviously, they're flying. Who else have you seen that's impressed you so far this afternoon?
I think the way it's gone, I mean, Millwall have played very well at Reading. I know Reading were, you know, a lot of people's fancy for this year after going so close, but they've played very well. Forest Barnes hasn't been an awful lot in the game. And Doncaster have acquitted themselves well. You know, you would have made them, you know, underdogs in this game, but they've more than held their own. So it's been a good afternoon, actually, so far.
OK, well, it turns out that Brian McLaughlin might also be something of a fortune teller because there's a goal at East End Park.
Yeah, what a game, Gabby. It's now Dunfermline 2, Cali Thistle 3. Greg Tansey with his second off the afternoon. It was across deep to the back post, knocked back across goal by Ross Stokely. And there was Greg Tansey hammering in at the back post to knock the ball beyond the Dunfermline keeper and into the back of it. A small band of Cali Thistle fans away to my right there cheering. The Dunfermline fans just cannot believe that their side are now behind, but they are. There's 7 minutes left for play. It's Dunfermline 2, Cali Thistle 3.
Let's go to Deepdale. James Mason, there have been a couple more goals the last time we spoke.
Indeed, it's been a cracking game, Gabby. Preston North End 2, Colchester 4. I'll quickly whittle through them if you don't mind. Anthony Wordsworth opening the scoring for Colchester. Ian Henderson getting his first of two just after the half-time break. But Neil Mellor, back from a Sheffield Wednesday season-long loan, stopped the rot momentarily. But Henderson got a second, making it 3-1 for Colchester. That's when it all changed. Paul Coote arguably scoring the best goal of the game to give Preston some lifeline. And then Coyote Odijeyi making it 4-2 from a corner. I don't think the goals have ended here, Gabby. It's Preston North End 2, Colchester 4.
Well, to give their fans there at Deepdale some hope, Matt's just made a great point that Colchester beat Norwich 7-1 on the first day of the season 2 years ago. Norwich went up in the end. So, some kind of solace there.
Maybe.
Let's go to Turf Moor. Damien Johnson, another goal.
Yeah, Burnley have an equaliser. It's come from the player who got their first goal, Charlie Austin. The ball floated in from the right-hand side by Ross Wallace, and there was Austin at the far post to nod firmly past Scott Loach. He's been an inspired substitution in this second half. 2-2.
Thank you very much, Damien. Let's go to the Gal Farm and hear about that Bury equaliser, Naz.
Yes, Huddersfield Town 1, Bury 1. No more than they deserve, Gabby. And it's the prolific Ryan Lowe, who opens his account. It was a ball played into the box, very low, and low it was. Turned the Terriers' defence inside out before lashing home from close range. An exciting 7 minutes or so in store here. Huddersfield Town 1, Bury 1.
Thank you, Naz. Well, it was a historic afternoon for AFC Wimbledon at King's Meadow. 8 years after the club was formed in a reaction to Wimbledon moving to Milton Keynes to become the MK Dons, they are playing league football. They started their account today against Bristol Rovers. They unfortunately didn't get the romantic finish to the script this afternoon they might have wanted. Scott McLeish opened the scoring On his debut for the Pirates, the 37-year-old was also involved after his acrobatics in the build-up to the second goal, which was eventually scored by fellow new boy Matt Harold with just 20 minutes on the clock. But the home side galvanised somewhat, and after that goal from skipper Jamie Stewart, their first in the Football League, they then pressed for an equaliser. They've achieved five promotions in nine remarkable years. They got the equaliser eventually on the 68th minute. Charles Adamino scoring from close range. And guess where he was born? Milton Keynes. So two all at this point on the 68th minute. But, as I say, it wasn't the romantic end of the afternoon that they might have liked, because with just 5 minutes to go, Brett Johnson handled inside the box, which gave Adam Virgo the chance to win the game from the spot. And Virgo made no mistake, giving New Rovers boss Paul Buckle a winning start. But welcome to the Football League AFC Wimbledon, and Rovers certainly tipped for good things this season from the guys here earlier on. Looked very impressive. Let's go to the Amex Stadium. Tony Husband has a goal to tell us about.
It's a goal for Brighton, an equaliser from substitute Will Buckley. Free kick was swung into the penalty area, it was headed away. It dropped to Buckley, the sub, right-footed, and he absolutely lashed it into the back of the net, beating Gary Wood in the Doncaster goal. We've got a lot more than 7 minutes left here as well, because of an earlier injury to the Doncaster scorer, Billy Sharp, who was stretched off. So more like 10 or 12 minutes to play, and all level at the Amex.
There's a goal at the Majeski, Mark Bishop.
Absolutely incredible goal, Gabby. Reading 1, Millwall 2, substitute Matthew Mansett, all of 25 yards. Absolute snorter, top right-hand corner, is giving Reading hope. There's only 3 minutes plus stoppage. 1-2.
Let's talk about Will Buckley's goal, first of all, the equaliser.
Yeah, it was looking like a horrible day for Brighton. Obviously, Gus Poyet sent to the stands early on, goal behind, weren't playing particularly well. A great atmosphere inside the stadium, and it was looking like time was running out. Terrific strike. It's one of those, though, when a defender goes to try and block it, goes to his legs, perhaps unsights the goalkeeper. It's gone in his near post. Perhaps, if it hadn't gone through the defender's legs, he may well have saved it. But a decent strike from 22, 23 yards. Yeah.
Do they look like they've got enough to go on and win this?
Well, since Sharp's gone off, there's no doubt that, and it happened last year with Donny, that coincided with their dip in form last year. And he's gone off in this game, and certainly Brighton have come into the ascendancy and look the more likely the two sides to win it. But it would be hard, it'd be hard justice on Donny, considering the amount of players they've got out, because they've certainly played OK today.
And they could have been 3-0 up. Sharp had another couple of chances. Sharp could have had a hat-trick.
Definitely.
OK, we've seen that AFC Wimbledon have lost their debut game in the league. How are Crawley Town getting on? They're playing against Port Vale at Vale Park. Mark Webber's watching.
Port Vale 1, Crawley Town 2. Crawley sending a letter of intent down to 10 men as John Dempster gets his second yellow for two bad challenges, which have been the hallmark of the physical game that the promoted side clearly intend to play in this Football League. It's got them into good places, though, creating enough space for Tyrone Barnett to open up the scoring and Carl McFadzean to restore the lead. Port Vale's Mark Richard scored a fine free kick to equalise before half-time, and Port Vale have been better than Crawley when they can get over Crawley's muscular play. The Crawley fans have brought cow bells, apt considering this is a ding-dong battle. Port Vale 1, Crawley Town 2.
Thank you very much, Mark. You can see there on the video printer there's an equaliser at Shrewsbury. Plymouth getting their goal through Carl Fletcher, and Lindsay Hooper can tell us more about that.
I can, Gabby. It was a crisp strike, one to watch on the Football League show later from Carl Fletcher, the captain of Argyle, and it just flew. Ben Smith with no chance in the Shrewsbury goal. And Carl Fletcher, by the way, one of only two players in this starting 11 for Argyle over the age of 26. Nine players handed debuts, but it was experience they needed to get level on this one. Shrewsbury 1, Plymouth 1.
Thank you very much, Lindsay. Let's check in with Rob Nothman at the County Ground. Swindon were cruising against Crewe. Is Paolo Di Canio able to contain his excitement?
Well, he's pretty animated on the touchline, Gabby, but he's delighted to be watching Swindon leading 3-0. His team was largely outplayed for the first hour by Crewe's talented youngsters, but Callum Kennedy's penalty put Swindon in front. The Namibian international Oliver Rissa banged home the second, and Aidan Flint, a gangling centre-half who's been Swindon's best player, nodded in the third. Di Canio, as I said, has done plenty of arm-waving, especially in the second half, prowling his technical area in his sharp navy blue suit and red tie. But on his managerial debut, he showed he's lost none of his ability for writing a good script. Swindon lead it 3-0.
Thank you very much, Rob. There's a goal at the Majewski. What an exciting climax of this match, Mark Bishop.
Unbelievable scenes at the Majewski, Gabby. Reading 2, Millwall 2. It was 3 points all the way for Millwall. Reading have come back. Master substitution from Brian McDermott, the Reading manager. First goal, Matthew Mansett. What a goal, 25 yards, keeper David Ford, absolutely no chance. And then with just a minute and a half on the clock, Andy Griffin out on the right-hand side, swung in a terrific cross, and Mansett with a perfect header. 18,500 here have raised the roof. Terrific advert for the game. It's going to end 2-2.
Thank you very much, Mark. And another thrilling end to the game at Vale Park as well. Mark Webber.
Absolutely. Super sub Louis Dodd slips behind the defence of Crawley in time added on, taps in on the rebound to make it Port Vale 2, Crawley Town 2.
And another goal at East End Park, Brian McLaughlin.
Oh, what a game, Gab. It's an equaliser for Dunfermline this time. Martin Hardy scoring a terrific free kick, fully 30 yards out, round the wall and into the top right-hand corner of Ryan Essen's goal. Just 10 seconds were left on the watch, and indeed the full-time whistle has just been flown by referee Stephen Finney. A fantastic advert for Scottish football here. Dunfermline 3, Cali Thistle 3.
Hardy scoring, Inverness Caledonia and Thistle resting on their laurels, maybe. Let's go. It's been a while, hasn't it? Let's go to Boundary Park now. Richard Ascombe, full-time whistles blown.
Yes, Gabby, Oldham nil, Sheffield United 2. It's a work in progress, this, but a work that has lift-off, even if it hasn't been in the pretty passing style that Sheffield United boss Danny Wilson is renowned for. A corner led to their first, Harry Maguire thumping in a header, and the second was also out of the unfussy but effective football handbook. Stephen Quinn set free down the left to tee up the arriving Richard Cresswell. Cresswell, one of several players in the away lineup with championship experience, and it showed.
Meanwhile, the other Sheffield side in League One still playing, Sheffield Wednesday, Rochdale. Let's go to Hillsborough.
That's going to be a Sheffield win double, Gabby. I think Sheffield Wednesday 2, Rochdale 0. League One fair these days here at Hillsborough. Today, though, a couple of Premiership-type goals, although all but fans of Stoke City might find that debatable with the first one. It was a long, low throw from Julian Bennett and a power header from Rob Jones. Two of Sheffield Wednesday's summer signings combining in the first half. Well, Wednesday's second also came from a set piece, but this proved spectacular. A corner half cleared, and another of the recent signings, David Prutton, lashed a spectacular left-foot volley into the roof of the net. Terrific strike. The whistle about to blow here at Hillsborough. Rochdale offering plenty in possession, but nothing really in terms of penetration. 2-0 to the Owls.
Thank you, Alan. And a goal at the Riverside. Steve Sutton.
Yes, it's Middlesbrough 2, Portsmouth 2 in the first minute of 5 that's being added on. Portsmouth have got their equaliser. Luke Varney, another new face for Portsmouth, getting it. It was a speculative shot that rebounded to Varney. Varney unmarked in the box, all the goal to aim at. He made no mistake. Middlesbrough 2, Portsmouth 2.
A goal at the Coral Window Stadium, Harry Gratian.
James Hansen's got one back for Bradford City. 9 seconds of this game. Bradford City 1, Aldershot 2, Gabby.
Thank you very much, Harry. So things winding up around the Football League. Let's go to Vale Park. It's all over there. Mark Webber.
It is. No love lost amongst the managers either. Steve Evans and Mickey Adams squaring off. Security guards needed as Port Vale grabbed a last-minute equaliser in a ding-dong of a battle. Port Vale 2, Crawley Town 2.
Let's get an update from Greenhouse Meadow Stadium. Still playing there, Lindsay Hooper?
No, it's full-time here, Gabby. Shrewsbury 1, Plymouth 1 is how it ended. And Argyle came here scoring in the last 5 minutes. A crisp shot, and it's got to be seen on the Football League show later by Carl Fletcher, the captain. They haven't lost now on the opening date for 9 seasons. Shrewsbury will feel a bit hard done by. Shrewsbury 1, Plymouth 1.
Full-time at Turf Moor, Damian Johnson.
Burnley 2, Watford 2, a spirited fight back from the home side gave them a deserved draw. The visitors led through goals from new signings Craig Forsyth and Mark Yates. That after Burnley had dominated the early exchanges. Cathcart with a smart header and Yates a neat finish after a mix-up in the Burnley defence. But two substitutes came to Burnley's rescue. Charlie Austin deflected Keith Tracy's shot past Scott Loach. And Tracy himself, on his debut after signing from Preston North End, headed in Ross Wallace's cross. Burnley pressed for a winner. None came. 2-2 it finished.
Thank you, Damien. Let's go to Pride Park. Ivan Gaskell, the final whistle blown there as well.
Yes, Birmingham's cruel summer just got a little bit more miserable, really, though the day had started brightly enough. Curtis Davis got them off to an encouraging start. A few concerned frowns to be seen around Derby's dugout. Then Jason Shackle played a captain's innings to level it. Steve Davis added inspiration to the perspiration with a terrific pre-half-time drive. Bo Myhill didn't see it coming after Derby's slow start, nor did the rest of us. But Derby duly grew in confidence. Jamie Ward should have twice extended the lead, but didn't. And then one chance bounced off the bar. Another off the line. Burke hit Derby's post as Birmingham beavered their way back in a rousing finish, but Derby saw it over the line.
Thank you, Ivan. Another injury at the Amex, so it looks like it's going to be a delayed finish between Brighton and Doncaster, but it's all over there at the City Ground. Andrew James, you still didn't see a goal.
Yes, huge disappointment for Nottingham Forest and 22,000 of their fans. Gabby, 0-0, it finished. And you know, normally you have about a couple of sides of paper to report on these matches. Barely finished, side one. Very few chances from either side. Barnsley will be by far the happier. Forest have got some problems to sort out. They need more players. They lost 9 in the summer. They've only brought 3 in, and it showed today. Forest 0, Barnsley 0.
And it's all over at London Road. Steve Lee, a good comeback from the home side.
Yes, it was. Peterborough 2, Palace 1. An inspiring second half from Darren Ferguson's side, trailing deservedly to Scott Scannell's first half opener for Palace. Peterborough simply rolled up their sleeves in the second half and put a shift in. Grant McCann drilled them level with a left footer after a well-worked free kick. And then the industrious Lee Tomlin crossed for sub David Ball to head them into the lead. After a yo-yo season when they were last in the Championship, Peterborough showed their intent this afternoon. Peterborough 2, Palace 1.
7 minutes of extra time, I'm just hearing, at the Amex Stadium. So they're making the most of their first day at their new stadium. It's lasting longer than anybody else. Let's go to Ashton Gate, where it is all over. And a great start to the season from Ipswich. Marshall.
Yeah, they've beaten Bristol City by 3-0. The Tractor boys up and running and in some style. Michael Chopra, one of 6 debutants, scored a goal in each half, underlying why he is so valuable at this level. Lee Martin got the other as City lost 3-0 at home for the second season opener in a row. They've got major work to do. More of the same, please, for Ipswich.
Thank you, Hamish. To the Majewski Stadium now, and a brilliant finish from the home side, Mark Bishop.
Unbelievable scenes here at the Majewski, Gabby. Reading 2, Millwall 2, all 4 goals in the second half. Last season's playoff finalists coming back from 2 down to earn themselves a thrilling draw in front of more than 18,500. Millwall without a league win over Reading since 2004. They came flying out of the traps after the interval. 2 close-range headers from former Royal Darius Henderson and then Steve Claridge look-alike John Marquis putting Millwall into the ascendancy. Reading on the ropes, surely it was all over. But then a brace from substitute Matthew Mansett. The first, a 25-year-old Thunderbolt, top right-hand corner. Watch it tonight on the Football League Show. And then the perfect header from Mansett again. Great cross from the veteran defender, Andy Griffin. Have to mention, though, Adam Federici, the Reading goalkeeper, absolutely outstanding. Stoppage time saved to deny Scott Barron. Great effort for the game. 2-2.
Mark, let's go to the Riverside Stadium. A cruel finish for the home side, Steve Sutton.
Yes, it's finished Middlesbrough 2, Portsmouth 2. Gabby, Middlesbrough took the lead in the first half through Marvin Emners. It had to be set against the run of play. But a couple of minutes into the second half, David Norris had equalised for Portsmouth before Rhys Williams restored the home lead. Running towards the end of the game, the referee's assistant signalled 5 minutes added on time. 2 of those were on the clock when Luke Varney struck the equaliser. And in all honesty, Portsmouth might well have gone on to steal the match in those 5 extra minutes. The final score, Middlesbrough 2, Portsmouth 2.
Let's go to Tannadice. It's all over there. Ian Turner.
A real value for money encounter at Tannadice. Chances all over the place. Confrontations, contentious decisions, a red card and a goal apiece. Ex-Cardiff striker Stephen Thompson put Saints in front early on. But they were set back on the stroke of half-time when Nigel Hasselbank saw red. It was all United after the break and captain John Daly prodded home the equaliser midway through the half to set up a frantic finish. It finished 1-1.
Thanks, Ian. It's not over at Adams Park, but there is a bit of late drama. Lizzie Greenwood-Hughes.
Yes, Wickham are down to 10 men. Ben Strevens has just been sent off, basically for antagonising the Scunthorpe players. He didn't get up after a challenge and all the players kind of piled in and it looked a bit of handbags. Didn't actually see any punches thrown, but Ben Strevens was sent off and a Scunthorpe player had a yellow card. It is still 1-1. Oh, no! Scunthorpe! No, it's been disallowed. Scunthorpe had just scored. It's been disallowed. I think he must have been offside. Who knows how long it's to go? I would say they can't can't be more than about a minute left of play. But as I say, at the moment, Wycombe Wanderers 1, Scunthorpe United 1. It's all happening here.
Indeed. Thank you very much, Lizzie. It's all over, though, at Hillsborough. Alan Biggs?
Yes, it is, and it's culminated in a 2-0 victory for Sheffield Wednesday over Rochdale. No disrespect to the likes of Rochdale, but that really is an excellent result for Sheffield Wednesday these days. And they did it in pragmatic fashion, a tight-knit performance, never looking like conceding goals against a Rochdale team who had more of the ball, I thought, at times. Ashley Grimes hit the post with a 20-yard curler, but they couldn't match the penetration at the other end from set pieces provided by Rob Jones and then by David Prutton, resulting in Sheffield Wednesday 2, Rochdale 0.
Thanks, Alan. Let's go to Deepdale. Not a great start for Phil Brown's Preston. James Mason?
No, Gabby. Preston 2, Colchester 4. 6 goals. There should have been more. A surprise result for Colchester. Anthony Wordsworth opened the scoring. Ian Henderson scored 2. And Coyote Odijay finishing Preston off at the death. Neil Mellon, Paul Coutts did score for Preston. And there were signs that they could get better as the season goes on. But it's Colchester's day. Preston North End 2, Colchester United 4.
Well, would you believe it? There's a goal at the Amex Stadium. Tony Husband.
Well, it's fairy tale stuff, Gabby, and it's come in the 93rd minute of the game. Substitute Will Buckley, after being put through by fellow sub Craig Noon, opened up his body, beat Gary Wood to his left. He snatched all 3 points, surely, for Brighton and Hove Albion, with one of the last kicks of the very first Football League game at the Amex. Brighton 2, 10-man Doncaster 1.
And that was the kind of goal that he would say be more proud of perhaps than the first goal. Good goal, and had everything this afternoon, hasn't it?
It has had everything. It's harsh on Doncaster because they played the real part in this game. They've had two players stretched off, Billy Sharp and James Hayter, both off now. So it's pretty tough on them. You know, great story. First time at the new stadium. And it's looking like 3 points.
He was doing that last year, wasn't he, for Watford? He's come on loan. He's been bought now from Birmingham for £1 million. He's a good player, Will Buckley. He showed last year what the potential he's got, and he's come on and turned this game on its head.
OK, thank you very much for the moment, guys. Let's, though, get around the grounds and go to the Valley, where it has finished. Robin Bailey can tell us the story of this match.
It's a happy Valley. Charlton 3, Bournemouth 0. The summer clear-out by Charlton manager Chris Powell appears to have paid off. His 6 solitary wins in 24 games since January, well, that prompted action. Ironically, 2 of his new signings were from today's opposition Bournemouth. Royce Wiggins and Danny Hollands, booed roundly by the travelling fans, had good debuts. The playoff semi-finalists really looked out of sorts today, certainly in the first half when Dale Stevens scored a lovely goal on his debut. Scott Wagstaff's wonderful volley after the break was against the run of play after Bournemouth might have had a penalty when sub Lyle Taylor was felled. Johnny Jackson's penalty put the game to bed for Charlton after Bradley Wright Phillips had been brought down at the other end. So Chris Powell's revolution at the Valley has started well.
Thank you very much. Let's go to the Gal Farm. It's all over there. Naz Premji.
Huddersfield Town 1, Bury 1. Gabby, a point apiece for the sides here. An entertaining clash. Gary Roberts, it was, opened the scoring in the second period. Ryan Lowe supplied the leveller for the visitors. A cool finish after good work from the Bury frontman. Bury should have had a first-half spot kick. They nearly scored a spectacular own goal. Watch that on the Football League Show as Mark Hughes, whose effort was spectacularly saved by his own keeper, Cameron Belford. Entertaining and a point apiece. Fair result here. Huddersfield Town 1, Bury 1.
Thank you very much, Naz. Stevenage's first match in League 1. Andy Barwell was watching at the Lamex Stadium. Exeter, the visitors. And at least they didn't concede a goal.
They didn't. Tough season ahead, though, for both of these. The goalless scoreline doesn't lie. Both looking for that elusive scorer. In fact, this afternoon, the closest we came to breaking the deadlock was when the Exeter defender, Richard Duffy, almost put the ball into his own net in the first half. Only 2 seasons ago, Stevenage were playing non-league football, so I guess they'll be very satisfied with the point. It finished Stevenage 0, Exeter.
Thanks, Andy. Let's go to Harry Gratian at the Coral Windows Stadium. It's all over there.
Yes, it is. A young Raw City exposed by an impressive Aldershot. Hilton got the first on 20 minutes, converting Rodwell's goal-bound shot, and then Threlfall headed an own goal. Second half better for City. Size close, Compton 2, but no real penetration. Aldershot always dangerous. McLashan's 30-yard shot close on 77, but Bradford City managed to snatch a late one. James Hansen's header right in towards the dying seconds of the game. Too late. Bradford City 1, Aldershot 2.
The full-time whistle has blown at the Amex Stadium, and in the end, it did go to the script. And we've loved seeing their fantastically happy scenes pre-match today, Steve, and the hype and circumstance, pomp and circumstance before the match. It didn't look like it was going to go their way on the pitch, though, at times.
No, I mean, it looked like the occasion at the start had got to them, and, you know, Donny would have considered himself to be a little bit unlucky not to be maybe further ahead than the solitary goal. But they stayed in it, Brighton, and obviously the substitution, Will Buckley, from Watford, signed for £1 million from Watford, has turned the game. As said, he's come in, scored a super first goal, lovely strike on the half volley, and then he's made a deep run from midfield, not been picked up, and it's a really good finish. He's
a long journey home for Doncaster Rovers.
It's a long journey for them. You feel for them. They've lost two strikers today to a stretcher. Brighton will be pleased to get that first game out of the way at the new stadium. You know, they'll fancy their chances this year. They saw what the teams from League One did last season, Norwich, Leeds, Millwall, and they'll fancy their chances of getting promotion again. So, good start, 3 points, and they can move on now.
Manager to the stands.
Well,
I think
yeah, you get caught up in it, and it's not the Wood Dean anymore. It's a big crowd, a good atmosphere, and yeah, I mean, it looked like a decent occasion down there.
OK, this is Final Score, and these are the classified football results with Tim Gudgin now.
Yes, Gabby, off we go again with what is my final season dealing with the results. And first off today, results in the NPAR Championship. Brighton Hove Albion, 2, Doncaster Rovers, 1. Bristol City, 0, Ipswich Town, 3. Burnley, 2, Watford, 2. Coventry City, 0, Leicester City, 1. Derby County, 2, Birmingham City, 1. Middlesbrough, 2, Portsmouth, 2. Nottingham Forest, 0, Barnsley, 0. Peterborough United, 2. Crystal Palace, 1. Reading, 2. Millwall, 2. And Southampton kick off against Leeds United, 5:20. In the Empire League, 1. Brentford, 2. Yeovil Town, 0. Carlisle United, 0. Notts County, 3. Charlton Athletic, 3. AFC Bournemouth, 0. Huddersfield Town, 1. Bury, 1. Milton Keynes Dons, 2. Hartlepool United, 2. Oldham Athletic, 0. Sheffield United, 2. Preston North End, 2. Colchester United, 4. Sheffield Wednesday, 2. Rochdale, 0. Stevenage, 0. Exeter City, 0. Tranmere Rovers, 1. Chesterfield, 0. Walsall, 1. Leighton Orient, 0. And Wycombe Wanderers, 1. Scunthorpe United, 1. In League 2, AFC Wimbledon, 2. Bristol Rovers, 3. Bradford City, 1. Aldershot Town, 2. Gillingham, 1. Cheltenham Town, 0. Macclesfield Town, 0. Dagenham and Redbridge, 1. Morecambe, 0. Barnet, 1. Northampton Town, 0. Accrington Stanley, 0. Port Vale, 2. Crawley Town, 2. Rotherham United, 1. Oxford United, 0. Shrewsbury Town, 1. Plymouth Argyle, 1. Southend United, 1. Hereford United, 0. Swindon Town, 3. Crewe Alexandra, 0. And Torquay United, 2. Burton Albion, 2. In the Clydesdale Bank Scottish Premier League, Dundee United, 1. St Mirren, 1. And Dunfermline, 3. Inverness Caledonian Thistle, 3. The Ironbrew Scottish Division 1. Ayr United, 1. Hamilton Academical, 2. Livingston, 2. Queen of the South, 2. Partick Thistle, 0. Dundee, 1. Raith Rovers, 1. Falkirk, 0. Ross County, 0. Greenock Morton, 0. The Ironbrew Scottish Division, 2. Airdrie United, 3. Dumbarton, 0. Arbroath, 6. Albion Rovers, 2. Brechin City, 2. Stenhouse Muir, 0. Forfar Athletic, 2. Garden Beath, 2. Stirling Albion, 1. East 5, 0. Scottish Div 3, Annan Athletic 5, Queen's Park 2, Clyde 2, Peterhead 0, East Stirlingshire 1, Montrose 0, Elgin City 4, Berwick Rangers 1, Stranraer 2, Alloa Athletic 3. In the Carling Premiership, Cliftonville 1, Carrick 0, Crusaders 1, Glentoran 2, Donegal Celtic 1, Portadown 0, Dungannon Swifts 0, Coleraine 0, Glenavon 1, Linfield 2, and Lisbon Distillery 1, Bellarmina United 4.
Some friendlies you might want to take a look at the results of. A goalless draw at Hibs. Sunderland not getting off the scoring blocks there. Blackburn Rovers did, though. Four goals against Kilmarnock. That game was abandoned at St James's Park between Newcastle and Fiorentina because of the weather. Norwich got a 3-0 win against Parma. It'll be very interesting to see how they get off to Premier League life next week. Chelsea didn't make Ali McCoy's week any better with a 3-1 win at Ibrox. Wolves scored two goals against Real Zaragoza. And York City beaten by Bolton Wanderers by a goal to nil. Let's have a look at the SPL. Well, Dundee United lead the way after drawing 1-1 with St Mirren. They're behind the Tangerines in second place on goals scored. Inverness drew 3-3 at Dunfermline to claim their first points of the new season, but they remain bottom. Celtic will look to make it two wins from two when they visit Aberdeen tomorrow. Motherwell host Hearts. Well, currently on BBC Two, they're into the second half of the Challenge Cup semi-final between Wigan and St Helens. And there's highlights of today's World Cup warm-up game, Rugby Union, of course, at Twickenham on BBC Three at 7 o'clock, repeated tomorrow morning on BBC One at 8 o'clock. And at lunchtime tomorrow, and never mind who's the best triathlete in the world, it's a case of who's the best triathlete in the house, as two of Britain's big Olympic medal hopefuls, Jonathan and Alistair Brownlee, also good lead lads, lead the field at the London leg of the World Triathlon Series. The action starts from Hyde Park at noon. Join us for that one. Well, relegated West Ham start life in the Championship tomorrow against Cardiff City, who, of course, yet again failed to make the step up to the Premier League. Both have new managers, and West Ham's Sam Allardyce spoke to Garth Crooks about the challenge that lies ahead.
Well, I think what we want is, well, certainly what I want is, I want the thrills and spills and the delights of a promotion push by the fact that we're going to win more games than we're going to lose. I certainly hope we're going to do that. The experience of getting promoted at Bolton would you know, last me forever. This time, I want to go straight up because I don't want the trials and tribulations of the playoffs. Even though we won it, it was a fantastic way to get promoted. We want to try and get to the top two and be one of the top two if we possibly can. Historically, that only happens to one of the three clubs that are relegated, generally, over the last 5 years or so. So if we're going to be, you know, promoted, we're going to be that club, and Birmingham and Blackpool, are they going to be threatening as much? You know, we'd have to wait and see.
You can see how big Sam's West Ham get on tomorrow at 12:45 on BBC One. Ex-Cardiff boss Dave Jones and Lee Dixon join me for that. It should be very interesting indeed. The team that start tomorrow for West Ham might not be the team who start at the beginning of September, though, because David Gold was making his intentions very clear this morning on 5 Live. It appears that he actually actively wants to sell some of the big-name players to bring some cash in.
Yeah, I mean, certainly Scott Parker is the one you're probably alluding to, because, you know, he's probably going to go into the Premier League by the end of the month. Teams will wait till the end of the month as well to try and get that figure down as much as possible. Big job on his hands, Sam Allardyce. I think he's made probably the sign in the summer in bringing Kevin Nolan to the club. Matt Taylor also from Bolton, I think, is a good signing. John Carew, I think, is having a medical at the moment. So he's bringing some good players in, and I fancy them to be up there alongside Leicester at the top of the Championship.
Tough for Cardiff, regrouping. Obviously, a lot of players brought in, a lot of players, big names, that have gone out the other way, new manager. It's a matter of kind of trying to get rid of that, whatever it is that stops them getting over the line. They've got so close, they've had periods of the season where they've looked indomitable and then just failed to make the grade at the end.
Yeah, I think it's probably going to be a tougher year than ever this year. I thought it was a wide-open league last year. I think it was an ideal opportunity. And speaking to a lot of managers last year, you know, one or two certainly feel like they missed a trick by not getting out the division.
Capitalising on that, yeah.
Yeah, so I think there's a little bit more quality in the division, a little bit more depth to it. It won't be any easier, but as you say, big change around, and we'll be interested to see how that works out. It's a tough first game as well.
You know, Cardiff have lost some key players as well. You know, Chopra, Bothroyd, both gone. Chopra to Ipswich, Bothroyd to QPR. Craig Bellamy, will he or won't he go back to Cardiff? So all of a sudden, you know, I know they brought some good players in, Earnshaw and Kenny Miller. Is there enough in their tank to replace Chopra, Bothroyd and Bellamy?
OK, it'll be a good one. Join us for that, 12:45, as I say, on BBC One tomorrow. A big day, though, it was today on the South Coast. Gus Poyet's newly promoted Brighton started their life back in the Championship and in their new stadium against Doncaster Rovers, and Martin Fisher was watching.
Coppinger's centre. It'll come out as far as Hatzap to clear the crossbar. Coppinger sweeping it across. It was missed by Hater, and then Sharp, who would have expected to hit the target there. Hater's come back a long way to make the challenge. Referee has had a look at it, and I think the card's going to come out for Luana Wah here for trying to win his side a penalty. Well, you can hear what the Brighton fans make of that. You can see what Luana Wah makes of it. I think that Gus Poet is too happy about the referee's work over the last 2 minutes or so. And referee Ilderton coming to the sidelines now to have a word with his assistant on this near side, Robert Whitten. And he's been sent up into the stands. Calderon's ball in. It'll fall here for Barnes. Flag stays down. Barnes! And away by Friend. Robbed by Mason. Coppinger is with him. Sharp is there too. Mason goes himself. It might fall for Sharp. And it just about trickles in. Goal given. Billy Sharp, who missed a very good chance earlier on, puts this one away. First blood to Doncaster. The visitors here holding a very high line. Bridcut to curl it in. Naylor got a touch to it. Driven towards goal and in the back of the net. What a thumping strike. Will Buckley it was that let rip. And joy around the AMAX Stadium at last. 1-1. And look at the celebrations there. Oh, lovely feat. Needs to pick the pass, and he might just have done it. It's Buckley in again. 2-1 Brighton! And what an inspired substitution that has turned out to be. Will Buckley, who started the day on the bench, ends the day as a Brighton hero.
And as you say, looking like a very good acquisition from Watford.
Yeah, absolutely. Two terrific goals there. The first one was a good strike. The second one was excellent play initially. By noon, the pass was excellent, and the finish was very good as well. So, great start to life back in the Championship and in the new stadium as well.
And you know, perhaps the occasion did get to them in the first half. The nerves will be steadied by that performance and taking 3 points from it.
I think they'll take a lot of confidence out of it. I mean, it's always, you know, difficult moving up to another league. No matter what anybody says, there's a massive difference between each of the leagues. You know, we take it as just the Championship to Premiership, but there's an awful big difference between the others as well. And that'll give them a degree of confidence. And one or two players did actually look very comfortable today, so they look to have a good season ahead of them.
You say there's a big gap, but Norwich, Leeds and Millwall all last season coming up from League
One
did very well, didn't they?
Good teams that are coming up. But
Birmingham City have come down today to the Championship and have lost. Let's have a look at the goals that meant that they did go 2-1 down at Pride Park in the end. They actually took the lead, though, didn't they? Curtis Davis getting the goal for them.
Yeah, that was a good header. Obviously playing because Roger Johnson's gone and Scott Dan perhaps is on his way as
Jason
well.
Jason Shackle equalising for Derby.
I fancy Johnson or Dan maybe to have made that a little bit tougher, but that's it must have been a slight deflection on that for the keeper to dive under it like that. But it didn't look like it was going to finish up.
Suppose
Maher
with big boots to fill, really, yeah, there, and obviously all change in the defence as well.
Yeah, it didn't look like that was going to be the result, but you know, it was a funny game. It's a topsy-turvy sort of game because Birmingham started very well and finished very well, and in the middle, Derby got the two goals.
You can see all the goals, all the action from the Football League today on this opening day, opening weekend even of the season. It's at 5:55 on BBC One tonight. You doing that one, Steve?
Yes.
Yes, thought so. impressed by the opening day? Happy with what you've seen? Good standard all round?
Yeah, it's been a good day. I mean, a good start for Leicester. Obviously, Championship favourites, winning away from home. Darius Vassell was sent off as well early on, and they rebounded back from that. So it's a good start for them. It'll be interesting to see how West Ham Cardiff go tomorrow. Reading and Burnley, two of my tips for the playoffs, both came back from two goals down as well. So I say, first day, you can't read too much into it, but it's a long season.
OK, well, you two have both performed admirably. Pre-season's obviously went well because your fitness is right up there, 9 out of 10. Thank you very much. You can have your say. 6:06 is on 5 Live as usual. But from all of us, we'll see you next weekend. The Premier League season is on. Join us 2:30 on the red button.